friends, today I'm going to break down the foundational strum of all swing and ragtime music, the swing strum. We've talked a lot about the shuffle strum and triplets and split strokes and raciados and all sorts of fancy strums on this channel, but all of this, the basis of this music, the heartbeat, is based around this one simple strum that's really broken down into four separate parts. Part one, the pulse. Much like a living organism, all types of music have their own pulse or heartbeat to them that really drives it. And when we're speaking of swing music, remember that this music really started out for dancers. This has a very heavy four pulse. When we think about the role of the instrument in this context, while uke was popular in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, the standard rhythm instruments in the earlier jazz would be banjo, and then as we go up through the years, guitar really overtook banjo, and we're trying to approximate that role in the band, but we also need to understand how the entire rhythm section works. When we talk about swing comping, for the most part, people's ears go to the word Freddie Green. Freddie Green was Count Basie's guitar player in his big band that really revolutionized the role of the rhythm instrument in the context of the rhythm section. What Freddie was known for was playing four to the floor, or just four quarter note down strums per bar, with smally voiced chords, usually just two to three notes in the chord, which works really well on uke. We only even have four to work with. But we need to think about it in the broader role of the entire rhythm section. A rhythm section would generally have a chordal instrument, something like guitar, piano, banjo. Then we would have a bass instrument, either upright bass or tuba. And then we would have drums, be it trap kit or just a snare drum in some of the earlier jazz. The pulse is really the same. The guitar is strumming these four downstrokes. And if we think about the bass, it either has a two-beat bass line, or beating on one and three, or we walk the bass, it beats on four, linking up directly with what the guitar player is doing. And likewise, the drums, as we move up to the late 30s, early 40s, and get into true swing repertoire, we add the usage of a ride cymbal, which is that larger cymbal on the right-hand side of a drum kit that also is just pulsing four the whole time. So when we're trying to approximate all of this on the instrument, four steady down strums is so important to what we are doing. This is the heartbeat of the music. So if we put down a B flat sixth chord, open 2-1-1, and we can pulse just four down strums on this chord. And you want to be able to just meditate on this and get it to flow very nicely. We want to work on four even strums to start. Part two, accents. But we just have four steady strums to the bar, it doesn't quite make things swing, does it? What is just as important in this music is where we place the accented beats. In a lot of music, in blues and in rock and R&B, we generally have one and three accented. That is what we are accustomed to hearing. In swing and jazz, we accent two and four. So they are going to be slightly louder or more prominent than beats one and three. And we can think back to this in the context of the rhythm section. As we go up through the years and have a full drum kit, generally the hi-hat cymbal or the closed double cymbal will close on beats two and four, giving this sharp attack and really driving the band. And that's what pushes the groove on this. So how do we accomplish that on uke? And there are multiple ways to do it. We can do it by A, just strumming louder. So we can take beats one and three, make them softer, and two and four just a little bit louder, like this. Now, we could do that, but then we're thinking the whole time about strumming a little bit harder on two and four. When we're playing with our fingers, we have some different possibilities here. The first thing that we can do is change the texture or the tone of the instrument so that it is softer on beats one and three. The attack is softer, and then two and four has a sharper attack, also giving us the same accented feel. So how can we do this? We generally strum right where the neck meets the body on uke. But we'll get a softer sound as we go up by the nut up here, and we'll get a sharper attack as we get down by the bridge. Listen to the difference between the two. So just by moving our hand a couple inches back and forth, we have one and three by the neck, two and four on the body. And that builds in that accent for us by changing the texture instead of changing the volume. this is one way that we can practice accenting 2 and 4. The second way that we can do this is by using just a different part of the hand on 2 and 4. We've talked about this in the video for the flick, where we come down with the thumb on 1 and 3, and then the first finger on 2 and 4, giving us, again, a textural accent as opposed to an amplitude accent or something that is louder or softer. So you have thumb, first finger. But it's important to practice with accents, and one thing that you can do to really help your groove, besides playing along to old recordings, which is the absolute best thing that you can do, is become part of a band. You can set your metronome on beats 2 and 4 only, or as accented beats while you practice, which will give you this underlying strong pulse on 2 and 4. Part 3, muting. Just as important as the accented beats is how long and short each beat is. This also plays into our accent. And we accomplish this generally through left-hand muting, not right-hand muting, like chucking that we see in some other parts of the ukulele world. And the reason that we do this is it actually gives us a little bit more control. So what we want is a longer 1 and 3 and a shorter 2 and 4. Again, we're approximating the sound of the hi-hat in jazz, that closing cymbal on beats 2 and 4. So 2 and 4 will be a little bit shorter, but we're still going to mute 1 and 3 as well. So think of this as long, short, long, short, long, short. And this is also playing into our accents. So what we'll do with the left hand is after we play a chord, we'll just release the pressure with our left hand, and you can lay the rest of your fingers over the strings, especially if you're playing an open position chord like C, where you can't just mute all the strings. On B-flat 6th, it's a little bit easier. So we would have a sound that sounds a little bit something like this with the muting in there. And then if we add in our accents going back and forth between the neck and the bridge, it sounds a little bit something like this. We have that nice sharp attack on 2 and 4, nice short notes, accented, just driving the rhythm along. Part 4, ghost notes. In addition to our basic 4-to-the-floor pulse, we also have a secondary underlying pulse of 8th note triplets. Now, we've talked about this in the swung versus straight 8th note video, as well as the shuffle strum, and I'll link both of those below if you don't understand this concept yet. But very basically, we're thinking a triplet subdivision of each and every beat. So while we play 1, 2, 3, 4, what we're really thinking in our head is this. 1 triplet, 2 triplet, 3 triplet, 4 triplet, 1 triplet, 2 triplet, 3 triplet, 4 triplet. So although this is a 4-beat pattern, we're really thinking about a triple meter behind this, and that's going to help us evenly place our ghost note. So what is a ghost note? A ghost note is a note that we play rhythmically but does not have tonality to it. So this happens while we are muting the strings with our left hand mute, as we were doing on beats 2 and 4, to make these notes a little bit shorter. And what we can do is just a quick up strum over the mute to insinuate this triplet feel underlying our 4-to-the-floor pattern. So with our up strum, occasionally we can hear a little bit something that sounds like this. So you hear that little up strum on there that's just a rhythmic hit, and that's accompanying what we would hear on the ride cymbal, our 1, 2, 3, ta-ta, ta-ta-ta. Ta. So again, we are approximating the entire rhythm section. So when you're putting together this basic swing strum, while it is just 4-to-the-floor, what's more important are the accents, the length of the note, and adding in these ghost notes to help approximate that triplet feel underneath. And once you're comfortable with this, then we can start adding more complex strumming techniques to our toolbox. I'll see y'all next week.